Hallelujah. Well, it's so good to be here tonight. We expect miracles. We expect the glory and the presence of God in this place tonight. And I believe that as we preach God's word, that that word has no barriers, no limits, that wherever you are, that word will minister life, that it will be active, it will energize, and it will do something mighty in your lives tonight. So let's go tonight with our first Rhema Healing meeting online tonight. So we pray, Father, for the word sown into the hearts of the people tonight. We pray that as that word is sown into their hearts, we call for the rain of the Spirit to come over the word. And Father, for that word to go deep, deep, deep into the hearts of the people. And for the word, Father, as it goes into the heart, that it will begin to produce fruit, rich fruit, fruit that will bring glory to you in Jesus' name. So we give you all the praise and all the glory in the name of Jesus. Well, you know what the devil meant for evil, God has turned to good, because never at any time in history has the word been being preached online and out in that world as more as it is right now in Jesus' name. That word's coming into all kinds of homes and people's lives all over the world, all over our nation in Jesus' name. And we're very thankful that we're here tonight to be able to minister God's word to you. So we want to start tonight by going to Psalm 46. And I want to thank you for joining us. What a privilege it is to have you join with us tonight. And really, what a great privilege it is to minister the word to you, that we've had no restrictions, that that word can come through right now into your homes and the places that you're gathering tonight and bring life to you. You know, I'm always reminded of what Jesus said, that I came to give you life and life better than you ever dreamed of. So here we go tonight in the Rhema Healing Meeting. Psalm 46 and verse 10 and verse 11 tonight. I'm reading from the Amplified Bible. It says in verse 10, let us be still and know and recognize and understand that I am God. It'd be good to underline that I am in your Bible. That I will be exalted amongst the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge, our high tower, our stronghold. And it says, pause and calmly think about that tonight. And so I want to share a little bit of that tonight, that the Lord is with us, that he is the God of Jacob. And he said, I am your refuge, I am your high tower. And then he said, stop for a minute and just think about that. Think about how and who God is right now. Just think about him. Just stop for a little bit, that he is a refuge, that he is our strength, that he is an ever-present help in a time of problems. And you know, it means, as I checked that out today, it means regardless of what we're facing in our personal lives, that God is with us. So we don't need to be afraid, church. It means that we can take comfort in being in his presence. Oh, Father, and in your presence is fullness of joy. And I love your presence, in trusting in his promises to heal us, to deliver us in Jesus' name. Now, you know, the Lord really ministered this word to my heart, and the more that I've spent time in it today, just new things have been coming up from that word and ministering to my heart. He says, be still, and that means stop striving and relax. Stop striving and just relax in his presence. And he says, peace, be still. Stop worrying. You know, I looked at what that meant today. Stop worrying means stop being alarmed. Sometimes, you know, people can get a pain in their body. Maybe they get a little bit of an earache or something happen in their body and they get alarmed. Then they start getting upset, then they get uneasy. He said, stop worrying. Stop fearing and let go of all anxiety. And it's really important that we all do that, especially in the times that we're living in, but personally in our own lives. You know, if you get a twinge in your body, you need to just not focus on that. Just start to focus on the glory and the presence of God. Let's go right now. Let's turn in our Bibles to John chapter 14. And I'm going to read a little bit from the Amplified Bible. And then I'm going to read from the Passion Bible. In John 14, verse 1, he says, do not let your hearts be troubled, distressed, agitated. You believed, you adhered, you trusted in, and you relied on God. Believe in and adhere to and trust and rely on me. Then in verse 27, he says this, peace I leave with you. My own peace I now give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Do not let your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Stop allowing yourself to be agitated and disturbed, and do not permit yourself to be fearful or intimidated or cowardly or unsettled. Church, just listen to this in the Passion Bible. I'm passionate about the Passion Bible. In verse 1, it says, don't worry and don't surrender to fear. For you believed in God, now trust and believe in me also. Then in verse 27 again, he says, I leave the gift of peace with you. Oh, my peace. Not the kind of fragile peace the world gives you, but my perfect peace. Don't yield to fear or be troubled in your heart. Instead, be courageous. Don't yield to the fear. Fear will present itself to all of us. But just because it presents itself to us doesn't mean we have to yield to it. And he says, don't fear. You know, a lot of times when we get a report or something happens in our life or our body's not really at the place that it should be. Sometimes Christians go straight, they yield to the fear, or they go into an automatic, by your stripes I'm healed, by your stripes I'm healed, by your stripes I'm healed. That's not really what God wants us to do. And I'd like to give you a little bit of a testimony tonight of something that we went through and how we journeyed through that. It may help you. It doesn't mean that you copy what I do. It means that it helps us to go to the Lord for instructions on anything that faces our life. You need to get the mind of Christ and the wisdom of God, or how to walk in that journey and come out the other side, healed, whole, and free in Jesus' name. And you know, about 3.5 years ago, we had a big trial, a big thing that faced our life, something we never anticipated. And you know, we went to the Lord in that, and he literally walked us through that, and still today walks us through that. And then at the end of 2018, going into 2019, I had two special people in my life at the same time receive reports in their bodies. And I'm passionate about these people in my life. I love them with all my heart, and they both received not nice reports. And you know, you go home and there is a sense of fear is approaching you, and you literally have to not yield to that. And so what I did is I went to the Lord for instruction of what my part was to play in that. And I went to him and I said, Father, I just need your wisdom in this. I need the mind of the Spirit of God in this. And you know, as I got up the next morning, I started to praise him. And you know, I pray to pray. What does that mean? When I first get up to spend time with the Lord, I spend time in praise. I just praise him and honor him and magnify him because he is an absolutely awesome God. And I said, Father, you know, I know a certain amount about healing, and I know that, definitely know that you're the healer, but what am I to do in this? Two on both sides of me have come back with identical reports. Two people that I'm very passionate about, that I love with all my heart. What am I to do? And the Lord began to say to me, or shall I say, something came into my heart and began to rise up in my heart. And I felt like the Lord spoke to me and he said, Eileen, get up extra early every day and begin to pray in the Spirit over this situation. And as I got up and I began to pray in tongues, the Lord led me to Isaiah 40. Prepare the way of the Lord. Make ready the way of the Lord. Clear the obstacles. Make a smooth path for the Lord. And so I said, Father, how do I go about that? He said, by praying in the Spirit. And then words that would come up in my prayer time, I would begin to speak out and know that there was a preparing. And then he began to take me through Isaiah 40. And he said, this is why you're preparing the way. It's so that the glory and the splendor and the majesty will be revealed in this and in both their lives. And I can tell you, lots of things on that journey, but you know, just to shorten it tonight, I can tell you something, that we seen the glory and the splendor and the majesty of God right in the midst of that. Because you have to learn not to yield to the fear. You have to yield to the promise of God. You have to yield to the Spirit of God and get his instruction for the pathway that you need to walk through that. Glory to God. And this is interesting because this is what's been speaking to me today to bring to you tonight. And so I really am encouraged to be bringing this tonight. He says in that scripture, be still and know. And all of a sudden, as I sat in those words today, all of a sudden I thought, wow, you can't be still in a situation unless you know. And that's why we have people moving to and fro and in and out, and they get agitated because they don't know. You cannot be still if you don't know. And you can't walk through something on someone else's knowing. You know, I've shared this a lot in healing school. I've shared it in church when we minister. It's wonderful what Brother Copeland, what Brother Hagen brought to our lives. They brought instruction. They brought revelation. They brought truth to our lives. But we have to make that real in our lives. It has to become a revelation in our lives, because that's where the knowing comes. That's where the anchoring comes. And that's where you can walk through to the other side.
Amen.
You have to know that for yourself. And so that's what we had to do. Knowing is what produces the anchor and the stillness in your hearts. Because once you know that you know that you know. Come on, church, you know that you're born again. I couldn't talk you out of your salvation because you spent so much time in scriptures on your salvation. You know that you know that you know. And it wouldn't matter what I said. I could not talk you out of that. And because of that, there's a stillness on that side of salvation for you, because you know that you're saved. You know that Jesus Christ is Lord. And you know that one day to be absent from your body is to be present with the Lord. But we have to build the same thing into our life in all other areas. And that's why Ephesians 1:16-20 is so important, because he said this, pray for the spirit of wisdom and revelation, that the eyes of your understanding be enlightened where healing is concerned. That we need to understand that in our life. We need to understand and go to the Lord with that. So we need to know that. And when we know the stillness comes, that we're not swaying to and fro, we're not anxious, we're not uneasy, because we know that we know. Stillness, again, it comes from what you know. And it's what you know right down in your heart. And that comes, that knowing in your heart comes from spending time. You've heard Brother Copeland's testimonies on how him and Gloria were poor. They didn't have any money. And they got Brother Hagen's reel-to-reel tapes on prosperity. And what did Brother Copeland do? He locked himself away till that message on prosperity became his message, till it became his word, till it started moving up from his heart and flowing out of his mouth. He was anchored in that. And yet when that knowing came to him, he still had an old truck. He still didn't have the dollars in the bank. In fact, he told you in one offering he had to give a pencil or a pen as an offering, because he didn't have anything else to give. But you see what that development in him has done, because you can see where he is now to where he's come from, because he gave himself to the Word of God. And we can do no less. You might say, yeah, but he gave himself to the Lord because he's a prophet, because he's a preacher. No, he didn't. He gave himself to the Lord because he was a believer that wanted to get out of poverty. He wanted to be able to provide for his family. He gave himself to the Lord because he wanted to know the healing presence of God, that when he laid hands on the sick would recover. And that's what we have to do. We have to yield and give ourselves to God till it goes down deep in our hearts. That we know, that we know, that we know, that regardless of that pain or that situation that's happening in our body, of all that stuff that's going on around us, we know that God hasn't changed. You know, we're seeing that in the nation and the nations right now. There's been a change in things that we can do and can't do. But even though there's a change out there, let me tell you some news today. The nation may have changed, but God hasn't changed. He's the same yesterday, today, and he'll be the same tomorrow. Amen. And I want you to know that tonight. And God is a healer. God is a provider in our life. And he said, Eileen, be still and know. And you know, to be able to minister the gospel, to be able to ever get up and preach, I had to do what I'm encouraging you to do. I couldn't live on other ministers' revelations. I listened. I listened to the instructions that God had given them and what they did with those instructions to get free in different areas of their life. And I had to do the same to break free from fear. Fear controlled me. Fear constantly spoke to me. Fear only allowed me to go so far before it started pulling me back. And I had to break out of those restrictions to let the call of God in my life begin to come forth and for the plan of God to be fulfilled in my life. Amen. So he said, be still and know. In Colossians chapter 3, let's go there tonight. Colossians, and again, I'm reading from the Amplified Bible. I probably will coast over to the Passion. But Colossians 3 and verse 2 says, be earnest. Oh, sorry, wrong one. Chapter 3 and verse 2, and it says, and set your minds and keep them set on what is above, the higher things, and not on the things of the earth. You see, when fear presents itself, what does it do? It's pulling you down all the time. And it's making you feel weary. It's making you feel inferior. It's tormenting you. But he says, set your minds and keep them set on what is above. And then in the Passion Bible, listen to this. I love it. It says, yes, feast on all the treasures of the heavenly realm and fill your thoughts with heavenly realities and not on the distractions of the natural realm. And that's what we all have to do. You know, that's how we get lifted up. And then we begin to lift God up as our healer, as our deliverer. You begin to feed and feast yourself on his word, Oh, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Forget not all his benefits. He forgives all our iniquities. He heals all of our diseases. He's redeemed our life from the pit and corruption. He beautifies, he dignifies, he crowns us with loving kindness and tender mercies, so that our youth renewed is like the eagles. Wow, I love that part of the scripture. I like the thought that my youth is being renewed. Glory be to God. But it says that we need to feed and feast on it. And remember this. I want to encourage you in this. You know, I've been through things in my health, in my body, in our very early days of ministry. So you know what? I'm not preaching just someone else's experience. I've traveled this road. And you do. You have to spend that time, because that word begins to anchor you. When things are coming against your soul, when pressure is on your body, when those outside circumstances seem to be mounting up against you, but you go and hide yourself in the presence of God, and you begin to spend time in his word, and that peace begins to come to your heart. It begins to come to your soul. It wraps itself around you. You know, I want to tonight let you know that God is with us. That means, church, wherever you are tonight receiving this word, that God hasn't forsaken you. And I want you to know that, because one of the enemy's real tools that he tries on all of us is to let us feel like we're forsaken. And that word forsaken means that we've been rejected or deserted, but God hasn't deserted you. He hasn't forsaken you. You're not abandoned. That means that he's quit on you and left you. No, he hasn't. He said, I will always be with you. I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. And you're not alone. You know, and I especially want to say that at this time to people living on their own physically, in homes and places right now, that even though you may live physically on your own, you're never alone, because he's always with you. And he's a protector, a defender, a healer, a provider. The Bible says his eyes are on the righteous and his ears are open to our prayers. And you know, we're not trying to make things happen by ourselves. You're not trying to do that. He says, be still and know that God's on your side, that he is your healer, that he is El Shaddai, the God that is more than enough. Why don't you take a little bit of time to sit in that and chew on that and go over that, that he's with you, that he never leaves you, he never forsakes you, he's always there. You know, Exodus 14, verse 13, and I'm just going to read that to you in the Living Bible. It says, but Moses told them, do not be afraid. Don't be afraid. Stand still and watch, it says, and or see the Lord rescue you today. Stand still. I want you to do that. Just take time and just sit in the presence of God and praise him. We may not know every single thing in the Bible, but you can praise him on what you do know. And we do know that he's a God that loves us, that holds us in the palm of his hand, and he'll never let us go. That he is a healer. He's a deliverer. That's why Jesus came into the earth. He said to bring us life, and life better than we've ever dreamed of. Spirit, soul and body, financially and socially, that we can walk in the presence of God. Hallelujah. And he says, stand firm in your faith. You know, Hebrews 4:3 says, when you believe, you enter a rest. That's where you can locate yourself. If you are in that place of believing, you're anchored in it, because there's a rest, it produces a rest. You may not see any outside evidence, but inwardly there's a rest, because you know. committed that to God. I believe that by the stripes of Jesus I am healed, that surely he bore my griefs, he carried my sorrows, yet I esteemed him stricken, smitten of God and afflicted. He was wounded for my transgressions. He was bruised for my iniquities. The chastisement for my peace was laid upon him. And by each stripe that wounded Jesus, we are healed and made whole. By those stripes, he was absorbing the sickness. He was absorbing the disease. He was absorbing the infections and the viruses. And I've got news for you. He absorbed it all, past, present, and future. So there's nothing that hasn't been covered by his blood. And when that blood was released by those stripes, we can absorb that healing that he released into our bodies, into our organs, into the tissues of our bodies. We can receive that in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Standing firm in your faith, standing with an expectation. Father, I thank you. I fully expect that word to come to pass in my life, not by my might, but by the power of the Spirit of God. And I acknowledge the Holy Spirit. Oh, he's with me to confirm that word in my life in Jesus' name. And how do we stand? Church, one of the best ways that you can stand is to stand in an attitude of praising God. It is praising him. You know, in verse 14 of Exodus 14, it says, "For the Lord will fight for you. And you shall hold your peace. Stand still and you will see." And I thought of another scripture when I read that. John 11:40 says, "Did I not say if you believed you would see the glory of God?" That word "see" means you would encounter the glory of God in your life. So then what should we be doing right now? Lifting our hands to the Lord and thanking him that he is a deliverer, that he is a healer. And we lift up our hands in faith to him. And he reaches with his hands of grace to our life. And that we can run the race because his grace is sufficient for each one of us. Father, we thank you. We thank you, Father, that you send your word to us. And that your word heals us. Your word delivers us. And we give you all the praise and all the glory right now in Jesus' name. We honor you, Father. And we honor the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you, Father, for the work of the cross.
Yes,
Father. We thank you for everything that was purchased through the cross, through the shedding of that blood in Jesus' name. We thank you for the power of the Spirit of God that moves in our lives, confirming the word, revealing the word into our hearts in Jesus' name. You know, in Mark 1, verse 35, it says, "The next morning, Jesus got up before daylight." I like to get up before daylight. There's just something about getting up when it's dark and it's quiet and you're on your own. He left the house while it was dark and made his way to a secluded place to give himself in prayer. I want to really encourage you tonight. Find a place where you can get alone with the Lord. And there's always that place to get alone with the Lord. We all have a place. You know, when we moved into a new house, I was kind of walking the rooms for a little while to find my place. In one room, no, I just can't find it in there. Then I moved to another room, no. And then I moved to a different part of the house and all of a sudden I could flow and move. And that was my secluded place to come with the Lord each day in my prayer. And you know, when you get into that place, you can go, "Father, I thank you. And I do, I praise you. I know that what you've spoken to my heart will come to pass. I thank you for it. I thank you, Father, and I honor your word in my life in Jesus' name, because he sends a word. You know, when you spend a little bit of time praising him, or you're spending time praying in the Spirit, you'll find that something will come up from your heart. Like for me, when we went through that journey last year, it was Isaiah 40. It became so real, so alive, so electric to me. And he gives you a word. He sends a word forward into your life. Here we still can make confessions. And can I say this tonight, just to remind us, the confession of the word wasn't to impress people with how many scriptures we know. The confession of the word ultimately is to persuade our hearts. And it says, you know, in Romans 4 that Abraham, being fully persuaded. So we have to get to a place where we're fully persuaded. And the first time I believe that God would have spoken to Abraham, he wasn't fully persuaded. My goodness, he had an age barrier, not just in himself, but in his wife. He had to overcome lots of things. When he looked in the mirror, he was seeing a mature woman and a mature man standing there. People that were long past at having children. And so he had to give himself to those words that God had spoken to him. And God will speak to us, my goodness, in whatever we face in our life. We need the mind of Christ and the wisdom of God to rise up in us and to give us a platform where we begin to move into. Hallelujah. And to praise him and to give him glory. You know, the Bible says this in the scripture. It says, while Jesus was teaching, the power was present to heal. And I believe that right now, that while I've been sharing with you, the power is present to heal. And all we have to do is receive it. So let's just, wherever you are, stand up right now and just lift up your hands to the Lord and begin to praise him and honor him. Oh, Father, what a mighty God you are. We thank you, Father, for all you've ever done for mankind.
Hallelujah.
We thank you, Father, that as we reach up, you reach in to our hearts and you speak to our hearts. And you give us that wisdom that we need for any journey in life, whether that's to walk through a healing storm, whether it's to walk through a prosperity storm or a marriage storm or a financial storm. You give us the wisdom that we need. On sunny in corne in po, breganama sini in cosima, bruno in po ni in cosima. And you know, right now in my heart, I'm telling you, I feel that there's someone out there, and you've been dealing with a migraine today, right in the back of your neck, and it's been there. And you're tense all in your neck. And I know that I know that I know that the power is present to deliver you right now. Now the Bible says, lay hands on the sick and the sick recover. So I want you to put your hand on your neck right now and put your hand on your forehead. And I want you to believe that you receive healing right now, because the power is present to release all that pain. Release all that tension in the name of Jesus, and to release that pressure all around your eyes. The power is present to receive it now. Receive it now in the name of Jesus. And the other thing that's just come to me, someone with their lower back, that you've had some pressure, some pain there, and God wants to heal that. He wants to deliver that. So I want you to put your hand, lay hands on the sick and they will recover. Put your hand on your back right now. And in the name of Jesus, we call healing to the back.
Yes.
We thank you right now for healing any inflammation in Jesus' name.
Yes.
Father, you said that Jesus bore our pains.
Yes.
So right now we speak healing into that back. And into the backs of the people. We speak healing into that person or people that are having migraines right now in the name of Jesus. And I'll tell you, right now by a word of knowledge. Some of those migraines are coming. Some of that tension on your shoulder is coming because you're carrying the care. You're carrying a weight over what's happening in circumstances around you. So cast it off on God. Give it to God right now, because he is the provider and he's not going to let you down. You're trying to work out every way you can deal with this, deal with that. You've got to let go, because you're trying to do it in the flesh and you're going to run out. You're going to get weary. So let go of it. Hallelujah. Now the other thing that came to me as I was preparing today is someone's got a tumor, or they've got something in their tummy, inside of them, and I felt all around here today. And I believe right now the power is present. And in Jesus' name, we call healing to you. That foul thing can't stay in your body in the name of Jesus. We release the anointing to you. And that anointing breaks the yoke. Amen. It destroys any burden in your body. That tumor
we believe
doesn't have any legal right to your body. We curse it in Jesus' name. And we call it to go.
Hallelujah.
Right now.
Right now.
In the name of Jesus.
Jesus' name.
And lay your hands right now on your tummy. And you say, I'm receiving. I'm receiving in the name of Jesus. The power's present because the word's been preached. And we thank you, Father, that power that's present. We're receiving healing into that place in that tummy area. Right now, we're receiving healing in the name of Jesus. We're receiving healing into that back area. We're receiving, I can feel someone right now with something. It feels like something, like a weight sitting on your shoulders. Just throw it off. Give it to the Lord. Don't carry the weights. You weren't designed to carry them. Throw them off on the Lord. Whatever that is that's concerning you, my God will supply all your needs. Hallelujah. If he looks after the birds of the air, how much more important are you to him? He loves you. Now, we may not have mentioned something that you're going through right now, but the power is present to heal you. So I want us together tonight to lay hands on a spot in your body where you have been going through some things in your body. It can be chest pains. It can be you've been facing something with the heart. You've been facing something in the knees. But wherever it is, I want you to lay your hands right now in that place, because the Lord told me, and he kept saying this today, lay hands on the sick. And I said, God, I can't lay hands on them all. He said, no, but they can lay hands on themselves and that power will go through and it will completely release them. It will release them. So as you lay your hands on that part of your body right now, we believe right now for the power of God to break that yoke over your life in Jesus' name. To annihilate that yoke and for it never to return to your life again in the name of Jesus. And we speak against heart disease. We call the healing power of God to the hearts of men, to the hearts of women right now in the name of Jesus. We call arteries cleared in Jesus' name. And we thank you for it, Father. We give you all the glory for it. And even now I'm picking up in the spirit, anyone having any problems with their hearing, with any infection in the ear, we speak over your ears right now and we call healing to you. The power is present, not because I'm here, because the word's been preached and the Spirit of God confirms the word with signs following. Amen. In Jesus' name. Yes. So we thank you for that. We praise you for that healing balm. Hallelujah. Jesus, you send the word and the word brings healing. And we thank you and we praise you for the healing power of God. Hallelujah. Now Pastor John's going to come and he's going to minister to you a song. You know what I'm going to ask you to do? I'm going to ask you to, whether you stand or you sit, wherever you are, I want you to allow his ministry through that song to touch your heart right now in the name of Jesus. And then I'm going to come back when he finishes, and we're going to pray, and we're going to close that meeting in the name of Jesus.
Hi, everyone. God is good. God is a good God. God is a great God. Hallelujah. Praise God. All glory be to God. Hallelujah. Be still and know that I am God. Be still and know that I am God. Be still. Never leaves you nor forsakes you. You can be still. You can rest in him. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Let's sing that again. Be still, O God. Do I put my trust in you?
So those of you that may have joined us today, but Jesus isn't Lord of your life, we want to give you an opportunity tonight to ask him to come into your heart and to be Lord of your life. You know, you can do that by saying this: God in heaven, thank you for sending Jesus to the earth to give his life for my life. And Jesus, I thank you for coming and giving your life for me through your death, through your burial, through your resurrection. I confess right now that Jesus Christ is Lord. I confess him as Lord of my life. I confess him as the Savior of my life, as the healer of my life. And if you have confessed him tonight for the very first time, I want you to contact us at the church and we'll give you some information that can help you to understand what happened inside of your heart tonight when you asked Jesus to come into your life. And we'll help you by praying with you tonight. And also too, if you have a healing testimony from tonight, and I'm believing that you will, I'm believing that power was present to heal. That power is still moving now, still moving in our hearts and moving in our lives, moving in those parts of our body that we need it to move in. And if you have a healing testimony tonight, we'd love to hear. We always want to hear at Rhema what God is doing in people's lives. So, you know, as we close tonight, I want you to know something that's so important, that God loves you. And he showed you how much he loved you by sending Jesus to the earth to give his life for you, to shed his blood for you. And he's personally involved with every one of you. He loves you. And so as we close, if you have that healing testimony or Jesus became Lord of your life tonight, please contact Rhema Family Church, Melbourne, on 0410 961 123, and someone will take that message, we'll get that information out to you, and we'll rejoice with those of you that received your healing tonight in Jesus' name. You have a wonderful week, and remember, God loves you.